You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome to HEA 100 Health and Lifestyles at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm Professor Christopher Capelli, and today is session four. Our topics are going to include components of a healthy diet and various aspects of that. Before I jump into today's lecture, though, I just want to remind everyone that we are being broadcast live. So if you have any questions or comments during the lecture, please feel free to call in. And there's the 800 number, and you'll be put on the air, and I'll do my best to answer your question. If you don't feel like calling or you don't want to call in, please feel free to write in, and I'll read your question on the air and do my best to answer it. Quick note for our Young Scholar students, or quick reminder, you will receive 2 points of extra credit if you call in, and 1 point of extra credit for writing in. All right, so today's lecture on generally going to be on healthy living and healthy diet. We're going to identify the essential nutrients and describe the functions they perform in the body, know and describe the guidelines that have been developed to help people choose a healthy diet, avoid nutritional deficiencies, and reduce their risk of chronic disease. We're also going to talk a little bit about making healthy choices. So, you know, the food that you can buy in the grocery store, the food that you can eat, what's actually healthy and what's not. Before we jump into that, I'll just briefly talk about aging. We didn't get a chance to talk about that last lecture. Just briefly cover kind of the changes that occur as we grow older. It's important to remember that, and this will tie into today's lecture on healthy eating, we won't see the benefits of healthy eating or the negative consequences of unhealthy eating right away. These are the changes that are going to occur over the next 20, 30, 40 years. And the problems that are associated with unhealthy eating, so if you eat McDonald's every day for lunch or for dinner, you're not going to see that right away. And the problem with humans is that we don't do very well with long-term planning, or we don't do very well with adjusting our behaviors unless we see immediate consequences to those behaviors. So if you eat a cheeseburger every day for lunch, you know, you may start off tomorrow feeling like a champ. By the time you're 50, you may be obese, overweight, may have heart problems, high blood pressure, and a whole host of other problems associated with unhealthy living. So what we do now will affect the quality of life as we enter middle age and our senior years. So there are some physical changes that occur as we grow old. There's obviously hearing loss. Anyone who has a grandparent probably knows that they have a little bit of hard time of hearing. Vision changes, which actually begin around early 40s, late 30s, your vision starts to change, so you may start needing reading glasses even if you didn't need them before. Generally though, most of these conditions can just be easily treated with contact lenses or reading glasses. Arthritis will develop, and managing arthritis can include exercise, weight management, avoiding repeated muscle use, and you could also be prescribed medications by your doctor. Another physical change, menopause, a big one that occurs in women, usually in their 40s and 50s. Some symptoms include hot flashes, sleep disturbances, and mood swings, and you can reduce problems associated with this by eating a healthy diet, exercising, and not smoking. So this is going to be the big take-home message of today. You can substantially impact your future health by eating healthy and exercising and not smoking. Those are the big three things that if you don't do them, or if you do healthy eating and don't smoke regularly, you will live a very long, happy, and high-quality life. And then there's sexual functioning. So a lot of people don't think about this as we age. You know, you don't picture senior citizens having a very high sexual libido, but sexual functioning is still an important part of many people's lives, and it still keeps going pretty much until the day we die. Now, I'm specifically bringing this up due to the due to the topic of condom use. We'll talk about that later on when we do talk about our sexual health lecture. But I wanted to bring up the point that senior citizens and older adults actually don't wear condoms at the same rate that young adults and teenagers do. We've done a really good job over the past 20 to 30 years at educating young adults to wear condoms every time they engage in sexual intercourse, and if they engage in sexual intercourse with multiple partners. We have condom use rates among teenagers at about 90%. So that means that 90% of teenagers will use condoms when they engage in sexual activities with a new partner. It goes a little bit down for college students, but it's fairly high. Among senior citizens, it could be half that. And I have a clip from a news story that discusses this specific topic. Mainly that STD rates among older Americans are far higher than they are among younger Americans because they don't wear condoms. There's a few reasons why this is, and we'll talk about it when we get back from the clip. But while we watch the clip, watch what's going on. Why do you think senior citizens aren't wearing condoms or older adults aren't wearing condoms? And why do you think younger adults and teenagers are wearing condoms at a higher rate? So with all those in mind, let's go to the news clip.
To sexually transmitted diseases, most people probably think college kids or young adults, not senior citizens. But more and more of them are contracting STDs. KCAL 9's Bobby Capel looks at the alarming numbers.
Why would a woman come over at 1:30 in the morning to see you?
Just why do you think, bonehead?
When Walter Matthau appeared alongside Jack Lemmon in the 1993 hit movie Grumpy Old Men, he may have been predicting the future without even knowing it. Study after study shows that seniors are having sex, and lots of it.
One lady has her husband passed away, and she has several boyfriends.
78-year-old Orlando Estrada is one of the many folks we found at the St. Barnabas Senior Center willing to talk about their age group getting frisky.
I was going to ask her for a date, and all of a sudden the wrong thing came out. Do you want to be my girlfriend?
And what'd you say?
I'll think about it.
80% of people 50 years and older are reported as being sexually active still.
Dr. Steve Raven, a Burbank gynecologist, says that along with all that sex, seniors are also contracting sexually transmitted diseases at a staggering rate.
In the age group 50 and above, we're seeing a double and a tripling of sexually transmitted infections such as chlamydia and syphilis. And that's just, it's startling.
So why is it happening? Doctors say there are several factors. For one, there have been major advances in medicine enabling sex at an older age.
They come up with a lot of things, Viagra, what it once called, which has helped immensely.
People are also living longer, and divorce rates among the over 50 crowd have shot through the roof. There's also more cross-generational dating. Couple that with the surging popularity of active adult communities, and the picture starts to become clearer.
There's a famous story about the Villages down in Florida, and there was all of a sudden this big cluster of syphilis, and it was, you know, found to be all these frisky seniors.
There was parties, there's activities, then also traveling and going places. So there was a lot of that's going on.
A lot of opportunity for hooking up.
That's right.
Education is another issue. Dr. Raven says because seniors can't get pregnant, many don't worry about using protection, and it's not really a topic of conversation as a result.
There's no reason for us to talk about it unless somebody has contracted the disease.
When you were in high school, did you have sex education?
Not really, that I can remember.
So what can be done about this growing problem? Is it time that we had the talk with our parents? Doctors say it might not be a bad idea.
My daughter, she surprised me one day. She bring a lot of condoms home. And I say, oh, who gave it to you, that Alka-Seltzer? And she told me, come on, it's not Alka-Seltzer, it's condoms.
If you're going to be entering a new relationship with somebody, and let's say you don't want to be using condoms, both parties in the couple need to be tested for these things.
In fact, Raven suggests that doctors also need to re-educate themselves and not assume that someone is not having sex based upon their age.
Sex never dies. It never died. And I, as far as I'm concerned, it could go on living till you're over 120, 30 if you take care of yourself.
Bobby Capel, KCAL 9 News.
I really think this is a very interesting topic, especially from the health field perspective, because we spent so much time educating people in high school over the past 20 years about the importance of condom use, and we're seeing the results. Teen pregnancy rates are down in the United States. Condom use rates are through the roof, so about 90% of teenagers in high schools will use condoms when they engage in sexual intercourse. It's slightly lower for college students, but that's generally because they're more likely to be in a committed monogamous relationship. But these senior citizens never received the same health education programming or safe sex programming that students receive today. So as a result, STD rates are a substantial problem among that older population. And then we can move on to talk about osteoporosis. So, I see that we have a call coming in, so I'll hold off on osteoporosis and go to the call. So, let's go to Katie, calling from Lakewood. Go ahead, Katie.
Hello.
Hi.
So you mentioned that arthritis is one of the physical changes that occurs with age. My grandfather was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis at age 50, and I was wondering what specifically happens during the aging process that makes you more susceptible to it.
That's a great question. So generally, this is something that's going to happen to everyone as they age. It's the joints kind of degrade over time. That's a normal part of aging. It can't be completely halted and it can't be completely stopped. But you know, with healthy eating, healthy diet, plenty of exercise, it can help things. Generally, people who don't necessarily eat the healthiest diet or do a lot of repetitive movements. So if you're sitting at a computer all day typing away, if you're constantly moving your arm in a similar way, or you're constantly moving your feet in a similar way, the same way again and again, that can be a pretty big risk factor for arthritis. It's just a general thing that happens to everyone. Some people have a pretty bad case of it as they age. Some people have a milder case. It does depend on the person as well and the circumstances surrounding that.
That makes sense.
All right. Any other questions?
No, I think so. That's it.
Great. Thank you very much for calling.
Thank you. Have a good day.
All right. So let's move on to osteoporosis. So this is when bones become dangerously thin over time. One big way to prevent this, obviously, eating foods high in calcium, such as milk. Mostly affects women, generally because they have less bone in their skeleton when compared to men. So this would be a sex issue as opposed to a gender issue. Preventing osteoporosis requires you to build as much bone as possible between the ages of 9 to 18. You're supposed to eat food rich in calcium, get plenty of exercise and vitamin D. Generally, it's a good idea to be out in the sun for about 15 minutes a day. Vitamin D is produced when ultraviolet light interacts with enzymes and proteins in our skin. So being out in the sun for about 15 minutes a day is what you need in order to have enough vitamin D in your body for the day. So you know, that's a great excuse to lie out for 15 minutes, take a little break from studying or from school, just kind of relax. And then comes the psychological changes. So these are a little bit harder to predict and a little bit harder to prevent as opposed to the physical changes. One of the big ones is dementia. And dementia is beginning to be considered a spectrum disorder, very similar to autism. So on one end of the spectrum, you may have some forgetfulness, some types, maybe you don't know necessarily where you are. And then on the very far end of the other side of the spectrum, you would have Alzheimer's or very severe Alzheimer's. Symptoms can include slight disturbances in a person's ability to grasp situations, as well as memory failure. One of the most common forms of dementia is Alzheimer's disease. And there are some steps you can take to ward off dementia. Specifically, you're supposed to exercise regularly, eat healthy foods, don't smoke, moderate alcohol intake, and use stress reduction techniques. So if you notice a trend in all these things that prevent us from experiencing pretty poor health outcomes as we age, eat healthy, exercise regularly, don't smoke, moderate amount of alcohol. There's also grief, which is a psychological change that occurs as we get older. Mainly this is going to happen because the older you get, the more people you know who are going to have died. Family members pass away, old friends pass away, and this is a very difficult time for people to move through. And then finally we'll end on psychological problems of depression and suicide. So depression is actually very common among older adults. Also, elderly Americans are more than twice as likely to commit suicide as any other demographic group. And this kind of ties into these other health problems that they've been facing as well. You know, if you're getting older and older, most of your friends or family are passing away and you're having all these health issues, you're going to feel far more depressed than you normally would have. And some people may consider suicide as an option. Of course, suicide is never a good option, but people who have depression are, it's a mental disease and they are not making rational choices. So these problems are becoming more common as we keep living longer. By 2030, over 30% of the population will be over the age of 65. So this is actually a very big health issue because as we move forward into the future, more and more people in this country are going to be senior citizens. They're going to be over the age of 65. So by doing all these healthy things we'll be able to move into senior citizen or adulthood or advanced age more healthy and more active and being able to just live a little bit better. All right, so with that, we're going to move on to the actual components of a healthy diet. So these are the things that we need to eat every day or the things that we need to do in order to maintain a healthy diet, in order to get all the nutrients, vitamins, and minerals that our body needs to be healthy. So your body requires proteins, fats, carbohydrates, vitamins, minerals, and water. Your body needs 45 essential nutrients in order to survive. So essential means that these are things that your body has to get from outside sources. It can't make them itself. So these 45 essential nutrients, if you do not get them from an outside source, from the foods that you eat, from sunlight, from some other source, then your body will be unable to function properly. Some essential nutrients we require in large amounts, such as proteins, fat, and carbohydrates. These are called macronutrients. Micronutrients are substances you need in smaller amounts, like vitamins and minerals. I have a question coming in from Hale. And he says, my grandfather on my dad's side died from Parkinson's disease. What is it, and is it typically hereditary? That's actually a very good question. Scientists are beginning to know a little bit more about Parkinson's disease, but it's still kind of, we're not entirely sure about the pathways involved. Well, they know the pathways involved, but they're not necessarily sure about the causes. Genetics plays a small part in it, but it doesn't seem to be a hereditary disease. Not like breast cancer, for example. Breast cancer, if your mother had breast cancer and you're a female, you are at higher risk of breast cancer. But that's not necessarily true from Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's affects the motor cortex in the brain and specifically dopamine transmitters. So generally people with Parkinson's disease will be given prescription drugs that contain dopamine to help with the pathway involved. I won't get too into the biochemistry of it. Generally, it can be partially due to diet, partially due to environment. There is some evidence that living in high polluted areas can influence the development of Parkinson's disease, but on a whole, it shouldn't be considered hereditary. Great question. Thank you very much for that. So back to healthy diet. Let's look at all the nutrients we need in greater detail. We'll start with protein. So proteins form muscles, bones, parts of the blood, enzymes, some hormones, and cell membranes. When consumed, proteins provide energy. The building block of proteins are amino acids. There's 20 that are found in food, 9 can be produced in the body. The other 11 must be ingested in order for us to get them. So that is, if we don't eat our diet that has the 11 amino acids that we need to survive, so they're essential amino acids, then our bodies will be unable to produce proteins in adequate amounts and we won't function as well or function at all, and it could lead to death in the long term. There's various sources of proteins. There's complete and incomplete proteins. Proteins are considered complete if they supply all the essential amino acids and incomplete if they don't. So examples of complete proteins would be meat, fish, poultry, eggs, milk, cheese, and soy. Incomplete would be legumes, nuts, and other plant sources of food. These are good sources of most amino acids, but usually lack one or two of them. So for incomplete sources of food, so these are generally for people who are vegetarians or vegans, those is a perfectly fine option for you. You don't necessarily need to eat meat, poultry, or fish, or eggs in order to have enough protein to survive. But you need to make sure that you eat certain combinations in order to ensure that you get adequate amounts of amino acids. Now, this can be a little tricky, especially as you're starting out, so a little research is required. But as long as every day you eat the appropriate amount of fruits and vegetables and other plant-based foods that supply the appropriate amount of amino acids, you should be okay. An example of this, peanut butter and jelly sandwich. The proteins in peanuts make up for the proteins absent in wheat, and vice versa. So if you eat a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, all the proteins that you would not get if you just ate bread are in the peanut butter. If you just ate a spoonful of peanut butter, all the proteins that you get in wheat are all the proteins that are absent in peanut butter, you get in the wheat. Again, this is especially important for vegetarians. So I have a clip from The Simpsons, and this is a clip of Troy McClure talking about the benefits of eating meat. So it's important to note that while you watch this video, that it's all obviously satire and tongue-in-cheek, so everything they say is pretty incorrect health-wise. But it's important to note that meat is not the only option. But if you do like meat, you should be able to, you should make the healthy choices regarding meat. Red meat is not necessarily the best form of meat to eat. It's been associated long-term with heart disease and high blood pressure. Chicken's a pretty good option, and fish as well is a good option. So while we're watching the clip, keep in mind what you think means adequate meat intake or adequate protein intake. They're pushing the agenda that only meat is an appropriate substance to eat, but of course, that's not true. So with all those things in mind, let's quickly go to the Simpsons clip.
Nothing beats a stroll in cattle country. Hi, I'm Troy McClure. You may remember me from such educational films as 2 minus 3 equals negative fun and Firecrackers, the Silent Killer.
Mr. McClure?
Oh, hello, Bobby.
Jimmy, I'm curious as to how meat gets from the ranch to my stomach.
Whoa, 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 slow down, Jimmy. You just asked a mouthful. It all starts here in the high-density feedlot. Then when the cattle are just right, it's time for them to graduate from Bovine University. Come on, Jimmy. Let's take a peek at the killing floor. Don't let the name throw you, Jimmy. It's not really a floor. It's more of a steel grating that allows material to sluice through so it can be collected and exported. Getting hungry, Jimmy?
Mr. McClure, I have a crazy friend who says it's wrong to eat meat. Is he crazy?
No, just ignorant. You see, your crazy friend never heard of the food chain. Just ask this scientician. He'll tell you that in nature, one creature invariably eats another to survive. Don't kid yourself, Jimmy. If a cow ever got the chance, he'd eat you and everyone you care about.
Wow, Mr. McClure, I was a grade A moron to ever question eating meat.
Yes, you were, Jimmy. Yes, you were.
You're hurting me.
So the clip is obviously providing you very incorrect information. It's obviously satire. Some of the points, though, we'll talk about. So they showed a picture of the food chain with all animals pointing toward humans. That's not an adequate representation of the food chain. And meat isn't, of course, necessary for a healthy diet. You can eat plenty of fruits and vegetables that would more than make up for the protein that you would otherwise get from meat. Interestingly, today or yesterday, the U.S. government just released new dietary outlines for Americans to follow. And one of the big ones, this is one of the first times they've ever done this, is a reduction in the amount of red meat that people are supposed to eat. The reason behind this was that the environmental costs of eating beef were too high. So usually in these high feedlots, they'll have cows stuffed together, and they produce a substantial amount of methane, which is a greenhouse gas. The cows aren't treated necessarily the best that they should, as opposed to being free roaming. So it's more of an environmental issue as opposed to a nutrition issue. But of course, eating red meat does lead to heart disease and other problems later on down the line. So I see we have a call coming in, so let's go to Olivia calling from Orange. Hi, Olivia.
Hi. You mentioned getting vitamin D from sunlight. What's better, to get vitamin D in sunlight or to use sunscreen to avoid sun cancer?
Oh, that's a great question. Thank you. Sunscreen doesn't block ultraviolet light interacting with your skin. It doesn't prevent the production of vitamin D. It will prevent you from getting sunburns. It coats your skin in a way that we can't perceive because we can't perceive ultraviolet light. But essentially, it just prevents your skin from getting burned. It doesn't prevent your skin from absorbing light and producing vitamin D. So lather on all the sunscreen you want. It's highly recommended you put on sunscreen every day, regardless of whether you're doing a lot of outdoor activity or not, just to protect your skin. But it's going to be fine. You'll get plenty of vitamin D even if you wear sunscreen.
Okay, thank you.
Great, thank you, Olivia. All right, so that's another thing that occurs when we age, which I didn't talk about. Your skin becomes all wrinkly, and you can prevent this, of course, by wearing plenty of sunblock. But that shouldn't interfere with vitamin D production. Burgundy writes in a question, I had a blood test done because of joint pain, and I was told I had arthritis at 14. How can I control it so it doesn't get worse at this young of an age? That's a great question. So there are a few things all of us can do to prevent or to improve joint health. One of the big ones, of course, is eating a healthy diet and plenty of exercise, not smoking. That's pretty much the big thing on how to be healthy altogether and how to help prevent or minimize the impact of health-related problems is eating healthy. So that's no junk food, no trans fats, no fatty foods, plenty of fruits and vegetables. Don't drink any soda, plenty of water, juices without a lot of sugar in them. One big thing you can do is prevent repetition of movement or repeated movement the same way. So if you're constantly sitting at a desk, for example, all scrunched up, that can have pretty negative impact on joints. So you're supposed to sit appropriately, ergonomic. It's called ergonomic, so you sit appropriately the same way. You take breaks every so often, so every few minutes you can get up and stretch and walk around. Stretching is also a very important thing to do. If the doctor prescribes medication, you should follow medication as the doctor prescribes it, so to a T. Don't miss any pills. Don't miss any medications if they provide ointments or other therapies. That's also something that could work as well. One aspect that I didn't necessarily talk about with alternative and complementary medicine, in some instances, there is slight evidence that it could work with certain problems such as arthritis or other joint pains. So in some instances, acupuncture could help. Not every instance, and there's a little conflict of whether it does help or not, but I believe in some health insurance plans are actually offering acupuncture as a covered procedure because it does help with joint pain and muscle pain. Just live healthy, don't smoke. Smoking is the thing that'll get you every time, and then you should be okay. Thank you for that question. So appropriate protein intake is about 10 to 35% of your daily calories. Shouldn't be too much of your plate. About a third of everything you eat, a tenth to a third of everything you eat should be some form of protein. Doesn't necessarily have to be meat, of course, but some form of appropriate protein from some source of food. Most Americans actually meet or exceed protein intake requirements, mainly due to eating fast food. So you're eating a ton of cheeseburgers, you're eating a ton of steaks, you're eating too much protein. Noah writes in with the question, since soy is a complete source of protein, is that a good source of nutrients because it already contains all the amino acids? Soy is actually not bad for you. It's a great alternative to people who decide that they don't want to eat meat, whether fish, poultry, pork, or beef. It shouldn't be seen as the end-all be-all of protein intake. It's really important to have a varied diet, and it's really important to research ahead of time the type of foods that you should be eating. But soy, in addition to other sources of protein, is absolutely wonderful, and I couldn't recommend it more to people who want to eat it as opposed to something else. Abigail writes in, what are the differences between fish, white meat, and red meat, and their impact on your health? Usually this has to do with the type of proteins found in these structures. I don't know the huge differences biochemically in these different sources of meat, but over the long term, I know that they do have impact on your health. Red meat, for example, is a larger fat source than, say, chicken or fish, for example, larger source of saturated and trans fats, which are actually not healthy for you. So in that way, red meat is far more unhealthy for you than, say, chicken, which is leaner, has less fat on its bones, and fish as well, which has, I believe it's omega fatty acids, which are actually very important for you as well. They can also be found in walnuts. So if you don't like fish, you can eat a couple walnuts, and you should still be getting the protein that you need. Speaking of fats, let's move on to talk about the different types of fats, otherwise called lipids. They represent usable energy, they help insulate your body, and they support and cushion your organs. Fats are needed in your diet, so all these no-fat diets are actually very unhealthy. Every so often, a new person will come up with a new fad diet, few off the top of my head that I remember, a paleo diet, Atkins diet from a couple years ago, other diets, and generally you never ever want to follow a fad diet. These are kind of flash in the pan type things, and they'll tell you to cut out one source of food at the expense of something else, which is never a healthy option. So paleo diet, for example, which isn't necessarily a bad thing, it'll say eat a ton of fruit and vegetables, which is actually a very good thing to do. Atkins diet, for example, said to cut out all carbohydrates. And when we talk about carbohydrates in a minute, we'll see why that was actually a very dangerous thing to do. Your body needs carbohydrates to live. If you cut out all your carbohydrates, you'll literally die. So these fad diets are not something that we want to encourage, recommend, or even promote at all. Generally, eat plenty of fruits and vegetables. A tenth to a third of your diet should be fats. A tenth to 30 of your diet should be proteins. You want to steer clear of fats, as we're going to talk about. And you don't need to buy a book or anything like that if you don't want to. Just eat healthy, research your food, and you should be doing okay. The trick for fats is to eat a moderate amount. So any low-fat diet is not going to be good. Or any no-fat diet, I should say, is not going to be good for you. You want some fats in your diet. In appropriate amounts, fat helps absorb vitamins, acts as major fuel for the body during rest and light activity. And there's several sources of different types of fats. So saturated fats, food sources would be red meat, whole milk, cheese, things like hot dogs. Monounsaturated fats would be olive oil, canola oil, avocados, peanut oils. Polyunsaturated fats would be things like soybean, corn, walnuts, flax seeds, and fish. And trans fats would be things like fried food, baked and snacked foods, and stick margarine. So it's really important to note which types of fats you're eating. Some are healthy, some are actually very bad for you. Specifically, saturated fats and trans fats are very, very bad for you. Trans fats are the worst things you could eat. They actually have no true nutritional value in them. They come from all fried food, baked food, snack foods. And these are things that we wouldn't have found in nature, you know, as we were evolving. So these are things that we really truly don't need at all in our diets. Some sources of saturated fats, such as red meats, are okay in very moderate amounts. Generally, we want to stick to unsaturated fats. So olive oils, avocados, things like corn and walnuts. So while we keep those in mind, I have a clip that I want to show you. These are people eating fried foods at a carnival. So all these foods that they're eating are going to be very, very high in trans fats. So as you're watching this clip of them eating this stuff, look at what the food they're eating is. Like, okay, well, that has trans fat in it. And then kind of judge. You never want to judge people, but see their body type, see how healthy they look. They're eating so many trans fats. Are they overweight? Are they obese? Are they underweight? Is their skin a little greasy from eating all these trans fats? And think about the impact that on your health or on their health that eating all these unhealthy foods can have. So keeping all that in mind, let's go to the clip.
Bung bung! The big rib. Pure beef. Just $2,000.
Am I gonna die if I eat that?
If you do, it'd be a good way to go. It'd be a hell of a way to go, man.
Just that there you go. There you go.
Welcome to Food Beast.
We got the garlic zesty sauce.
So they have like a 2-pound turkey leg wrapped all the way in bacon, and it's called the Caveman Club.
Turkey leg with a pound of bacon.
How many calories would you say are in that?
Shit, like 3,000.
Put some sugar on it.
Of course. No!
Crush on the
wall. Oh!
It needs more barbecue sauce, it really does.
That's delicious. Bacon covered deep fried jalapenos. Bomb.
So now, a lot of people wonder, how about eat all this shit?
Stay so slim?
And keep such a beautiful physique.
Deep fried bacon, chocolate, all in one.
Can we do drugs in this video? Is that, are we allowed to do drugs in this video?
Alright.
Now I'm high. Deep fried Klondike bar.
This is a jelly filled Krispy Kreme sandwich with fried chicken.
Deep fried frog legs.
That's the frog's ass right there. That's the best ass I ever tasted.
We got a Twinkie, we got the Oreos, and we got the Krispy Kreme sandwich.
I don't like candy.
The deep fried avocado.
I feel like this needs some barbecue sauce.
Right here, right here.
Come on, pussy. Vegetarian.
Fucking drama beat, son.
White Rick Ross.
I'll take a
white Rick Ross. White Rick Ross.
Sticker on the deep fried shrimp. That's not bad.
Sorry.
Damn, man.
This is called a nightcap.
All right, so you could see from the clip, some of those people were not exactly in the best physical shape. That's what happens when you eat too many foods high in trans fats or saturated fats. The body doesn't need that much energy in order to go through its daily routines, so it'll store it all as fat. Now, a little bit of fat on your body is actually pretty good. You need that for, you know, cushioning, for energy, for energy sources, but too much fat can actually have a very detrimental effect on your health. So many studies have actually examined the effect of dietary fat intake on blood cholesterol levels and the risk of heart disease. Saturated and trans fatty acids raise blood levels of low-density lipoprotein or bad cholesterol. So the more saturated and trans fatty acids that you eat, the higher your bad cholesterol levels are going to be. Saturated fats or trans fats are solid at room temperature, so if someone brought out a saturated fat on a plate, it'd be kind of a gelatin-like mold, and it'd be a little disgusting. Unsaturated fatty acids actually lower bad cholesterol. So if you eat avocados, use olive oil in moderate amounts, you'll actually lower your amount of bad cholesterol. Monounsaturated fatty acids may also increase levels of good cholesterol. So if you eat unsaturated fatty acids, you'll actually raise good cholesterol levels. Now, there's bad cholesterol and there's good cholesterol. Generally, you want to have moderate to high levels of good cholesterol and very low levels of bad cholesterol. And large amounts of trans fat can actually lower your good cholesterol. So unsaturated fats raise good cholesterol, trans fats lower good cholesterol, and raise bad cholesterol. But again, fats can be good for us. Good fats we talked about, the unsaturated fats can improve cholesterol levels and protect against some cancers. These are found in, again, avocados, some nuts, and olive oils. Diets high in fat can increase heart disease. Diets high in red meat can increase risks of cancer as well as diabetes. And generally, the recommended fat intake is about 3 to 4 teaspoons a day. So think about what a teaspoon is. It's very small. So you don't need that much fat per day, usually about 20% of your daily calories. So not a lot, but just, you know, a good amount. So an avocado a day, that's pretty much what you're going to need. All right, so let's take that and move on to carbohydrates. So whenever someone says, oh, I'm eating a lot of carbs, or I'm trying not to eat so many carbs, those are carbohydrates. And carbohydrates are essentially just sugar. They're used to supply energy for body cells, and some cells will actually only use carbohydrates as energy, specifically brain cells. Neurons will use glucose or sugar specifically for energy. So if you cut out all carbohydrates, your brain would be unable to function properly. So during high Energy activity, muscles use energy from carbohydrates as their primary source of fuel. So anyone who exercises regularly or who, say, is a runner, usually they'll eat a little bit more carbs before a run in order to get enough sugar. Now, there's a big difference between eating sugar and, say, whole grain as opposed to eating a candy bar, and we'll talk about that in a minute. So during digestion, the body breaks down carbs into sugar. That's the big thing about carbohydrates, it's sugar. And when sugar enters the bloodstream, insulin's released, and this allows sugar to be absorbed by cells. Eating diets too high in sugar can cause diabetes. It will cause problems with production of insulin. So while you have a lot of sugar floating around in your blood, it won't be able to enter your cells and provide you with adequate amounts of energy. And there's a few different types of carbs. There's complex carbs and there's simple carbs. So simple carbs, these include glucose, fructose, and galactose. Simple carbs are the things that add sweetness to food. They're found naturally in fruits, milks, and they're added to sodas, juices, and candy to make them sweet. And simple carbs generally don't provide very much nutrition for the body. So if you eat a candy bar, you're just eating plain, simple sugars, and they provide absolutely no nutrition for your body at all. There's a difference between simple carbs and complex carbs. So before we talk about carbs, I have a clip from Friends that I want to show you that illustrates what generally is going to happen to your body if you overload on simple carbohydrates. So in this clip, Ross and Chandler are in a hotel, and Ross has just been munching on candy all day. Just simple carbohydrates, no nutritional value at all. So while you watch this clip, watch what his actions are like. What's he doing? He's getting a little jittery. He's kind of freaking out a little bit because his body is overloaded on sugars, which is essentially what the body needs for energy. So keeping what simple carbs are in mind, let's go to that clip.
Hi, Chandler Bing. I have a reservation.
Oh, welcome to the Chestnut Inn, Mr. Bing. So where are you joining us from?
New York. The Big Apple. I'm sorry, he's a little bit wound up. We had to stop at every maple candy stand on the way here.
I ate all my gifts for everybody.
I'm sorry, Mr. Bing. There's no record of your reservation in the computer.
Well, that's impossible. Can you check again, please?
Check again, please.
I'm sorry, it's not here.
Not there.
Let me get this straight. I called yesterday to try to cancel my reservation, was told it's not refundable. Then we drove 6 hours all the way up here, and now you're telling me that we don't have a reservation?
I don't know what to say.
She doesn't know what to say.
Just give us the cheapest room you have.
Well, unfortunately, the only thing we have available is our deluxe suite. The rate is $600.
That's insane.
It is totally insane. Dude, let's drive home. We'll hit all the maple candy stores on the way back. And if they're closed, then maybe we'll tap a tree and make some ourselves.
Does that room have a closet I can lock him in? We'll take it. Totally ripping us off. $300 each.
Each? I'm your date.
So I pay for everything and have no sex. Life before Monica.
Dude, don't worry about it. I know how we can make your money back. This is a nice hotel, you know, plenty of amenities. We just load up on those. Like those apples. Instead of taking one, I take six.
Great. At $100 an apple, we're there.
Come on, you get the idea. You know, we'll make our money back in no time.
Dude, you're shaking.
I think it's the sugar. Could you hold the apple?
So you could see the results of eating overloading on simple sugars. Again, simple sugars have no nutritional content in them, but your body doesn't necessarily use them for, it doesn't have any additional nutrients, but your body still uses it for energy. They're digested far quicker than complex sugars, which we'll talk about in a second. So you'll eat a little bit of candy, you'll feel really great for a minute, and then you'll crash very quickly. The opposite of simple carbs are complex carbs, and complex carbs are the good ones. And these include starches and fibers, mostly rich in fiber, vitamins, and minerals. Due to their complexity, they take a little longer to digest, and they don't raise the sugar levels in the blood as quickly as simple carbohydrates do. That's why you don't crash after eating an apple, but generally you will after eating a couple of candy bars. And these act as the body's fuel and contribute significantly to energy production. So what you find in fruits, they have the sweeteners in there, the simple sugars, but they also have these other nutrients in them. They have fibers, they have vitamins, they have minerals. So eating, say, an apple, for example, is actually very good for you. You'll get a little bit of sugar from it. You'll get a little energy boost. It'll taste pretty taste. It'll be tasty. And it'll take a little longer to digest due to all the other nutrients that are attached to that sugar. And you won't crash as quickly. An interesting note about sugar is that humans evolved eating sugar. Our primary source of food for the past 200,000 years has been fruits and vegetables, which are naturally sweet. So our brains, again, use sugar as a source of fuel. So when we eat something sweet, our brain thinks that it's high in nutrition, or it's good for us because it's sweet, and it likes it because it needs it for energy. So when we eat something extra sweet, which is a modern invention, our brains don't realize, again, that we live in civilization and that the candy bar isn't any good for us. So we eat it, it tastes something exceptionally sweet, and it thinks, oh, the sweeter it is, that must mean it's better for me. There, it has more energy for me. So it wants you to eat all these cookies and sugars and snacks that are actually bad for you. Your brain doesn't realize that. So instead of eating those, you're supposed to eat an apple, other fruits that are high in natural sweets. They're not going to be as sweet as a candy bar because they don't have anything artificial added to them, but over the long term, it's going to be better for your health. If you're a diabetic, you're not supposed to eat simple carbohydrates. This is because once glucose enters the bloodstream, the pancreas obviously releases insulin, which allows cells to absorb sugar and convert it to energy. Without insulin, cells cannot take up sugar. With too much insulin, there will not be enough blood sugar for a person to function. So diabetic or not, it's very important to limit simple carbs. You know, eat as many apples as you want, load up on apples and other fruits, but think twice before eating, you know, the king-size bag of Snickers bars, because your brain doesn't know the difference. All right, so from complex and simple carbs, we're going to talk about refined grains versus whole grains. So complex carbs, so these are the good carbs, they can be divided into either refined carbohydrates or non-refined carbohydrates, which are whole grains. Whole grains consist of a germ, which is the inner layer of the seed, an endosperm, which is the middle layer of the seed, and the bran, which is the outer layer. During processing, so turning a grain into, say, white bread, for example, the germ layer and the bran layer are removed. Whole wheat flour will turn into white flour. Brown rice will turn into white rice. So what the problem is that the germ and the bran are where all the nutrients are contained. What's left over, the middle layer, the endosperm, that's where all the sugar is. So at the end of the day, when you eat, say, white bread, for example, all the nutrients that were originally in the wheat seed have been removed, and all that's left is sugar. So when you eat white bread or white rice or some other processed carbohydrate, you're just eating sugar. Refined carbohydrates usually retain all the calories but tend to be lower in fiber, vitamins, minerals, and other beneficial compounds. So if you have the option between, say, white bread or whole wheat bread, you're always, always supposed to pick whole wheat bread. If you have the option between white rice and brown rice, you're always, always supposed to eat the brown rice. Consumption of whole grains has been linked to a reduced risk of heart disease, diabetes, and cancer, and they also play an important role in weight management. So remember all these fad diets that come out that are trying to get you to lose weight, they'll say, oh, don't eat any carbohydrates, cut out carbohydrates completely. They're not telling you the whole truth. You're supposed to cut out refined carbohydrates. You should never eat white bread, but you're supposed to eat an appropriate amount of whole grains. Again, you know, the whole wheat bread, the brown rice, anything that's still colored is probably still going to be okay. Anything that's just white has all of the nutrients removed and it's just sugar. Unrefined carbohydrates, so the good carbohydrates, they tend to take longer to chew and digest and also enter the bloodstream more slowly. So when they enter the bloodstream more slowly, that means they're digested a little slower, you're going to have a more even level of energy throughout the day. So if anyone's ever taken an SAT prep class, they always tell you, oh, eat an apple before you take a test, don't eat a candy bar. The candy bar will give you a quick boost of energy, but then you'll crash and you'll feel terrible. If you eat the apple, you know, you'll have a steady stream of energy that'll last the entire test. So no white bread, whole wheat bread. Glycemic index is used to determine the type of carbs a food has. So a food with a high glycemic index has a rapid effect on blood glucose levels, which is not necessarily what you want. Something with a low glycemic index is a food that has a slower and more moderate effect, which is something we need. So it gives you more energy that lasts longer throughout the day. For people with particular health concerns, such as diabetes, glycemic index may be important consideration in choosing foods. So if you're diabetic, you probably want to lay off the white bread. Recommended carbohydrate intake is about 45 to 65% of your daily calories. So it should be about half of the calories that you consume a day should be from complex carbohydrates. Most Americans actually consume twice as many carbs as they need for their body to function properly. So in America, we just load up on that stuff. French bread, white bread, sandwich bread, deli bread, you name it, and we eat it. Most don't consume complex carbs either. So you're probably eating all those white rices and processed foods, white flour. Remember, a candy bar once in a while is okay. So it's important to note that as we go through all these health topics that you don't want to deny yourself something that you like. So if you like a candy bar, it's okay to eat a candy bar. If you like In-N-Out, it's okay to eat In-N-Out, but in a moderate amount. So a moderate amount of candy bar intake, maybe one candy bar every 3 or 4 weeks. A moderate amount of In-N-Out eating, so a moderate amount of trans fat intake, maybe once a month or maybe once every 2 months. Very little, but you can still eat it every so often. Remember, most sugar intake should be in the form of fruits and veggies, not in the form of candy bars. So if you're feeling a little sluggish, eat an apple, eat a banana, eat a mango, eat something that you like as opposed to eating a candy bar. Athletes in training will actually require more carbs than a normal active person. And added sugars should not be the major source of carbs, so cut down on soda. Sodas are actually incredibly unhealthy for us. Once in a while, again, is okay. Once in a while for a soda would mean maybe once every 2 weeks or once every 3 weeks, not once every day. Another example of a refined carbohydrate would be like a bag of chips. That would also be very high in trans fats. Now, specifically, I'm mentioning this because a lot of our viewers are in high school. We've noticed in interventions that people in high school, in an attempt to lose weight, will only eat a bag of, say, Flaming Hot Cheetos for lunch and at the expense of anything else. They think that because they're eating so little, they're not going to gain weight. But it's not necessarily the quantity of what you're eating, it's the quality of what you're eating. So just because you're eating a tiny bag of Flaming Hot Cheetos doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to lose weight. You're still eating something that is very high in refined carbohydrates, so very high in sugar, very high in trans fats, and very high in saturated fats. And the trans and saturated fats, again, are what gets turned into fat in your body. So in an attempt to lose weight, if you want to cut down on eating, you may want to just consider eating a lot of fruits and vegetables with very little actual breads. So eat, bring a fruit salad for lunch, bring some broccoli for lunch, maybe make a juice for lunch. And that's usually going to be a far healthier option for people than just eating a bag of Cheetos and a soda and calling it a day. You also get far more energy that'll last you through the day. So if you go to lunch and you eat your bag of Cheetos and you come to class and you're just kind of sluggish for the next couple hours until you go home, that's a good indication that you're not eating a healthy diet and your body doesn't have the nutrients that it needs to function properly. I also want to mention a quick note on fiber. Fiber is non-digestible carbohydrate, so we don't actually digest fiber, but it is still a very important component in health. Dietary fiber is found in plants such as grains, legumes, and vegetables. There's functional fiber, which is created in a lab and added to food. So dietary fiber is actually what's very important in our diet. This is found naturally in foods. We eat it and our bodies use that fiber in normal functioning. Functional fiber is what's created in a lab and isn't necessarily better for you than what's actually found in your food. So this would be like if you go to Jamba Juice, for example, and you ask for a fiber boost. That would be functional fiber. Fiber has different properties that lead to different physiological effects. So for example, soluble fiber found in oats can delay stomach emptying and slow the movement of glucose into the blood after eating. So eating some oats will actually cause you to feel full for a longer period of time while still giving you enough nutrients to work through the day. So if you always find yourself being hungry and eating more as a result, you may want to eat a little bit more oats. So you can eat a bowl of oatmeal, for example, and that will delay stomach emptying and increase the length of digestion so you won't feel as hungry later on. Insoluble fiber, like what is found in wheat bran, helps with digestion. And a high-fiber diet can help reduce the risk of diabetes, heart disease, improve gastrointestinal health, and aid in management of body weight. It even lowers the risk of colon cancer. So as long as you eat a pretty high-fiber diet, you should be doing okay. You won't feel as hungry, but your body will still be getting enough nutrients to survive. Now again, you need to eat this in conjunction with other appropriate sources of food. So you're supposed to eat, you know, plenty of fruits and vegetables, have your bowl of oatmeal, and you should be going okay. Don't just eat the oatmeal for every meal. That's not going to be healthy for you. And as a side note to oatmeal, I'm sure plenty of people are thinking, oh, I can go get the instant oatmeal that has all the sugar added. That is not the appropriate oatmeal that you're supposed to eat. You should buy the box that is just pure oats, no sugar added, and eat that. It doesn't taste as good, of course, because it doesn't have sugar, and again, we really like sugar, but it's going to be better for you in the long run and far healthier. So sources of fiber obviously are going to be plants, legumes, things like that. And your recommended intake, it's about 38 grams a day for men, 25 grams a day for women. Most Americans only consume half of this, and fiber should only come from natural sources, not supplements. And we'll talk about supplements in a little bit, but generally everything, every vitamin that you eat, every healthy thing your body needs to survive should come in the form of what you eat, fruits, vegetables, complex carbs, proteins, fibers, as opposed to supplements. So, you know, lay out the Jamba Juice. Jamba Juice isn't necessarily a healthy option as well because they load it up with sugar and yogurt, which is going to be an unhealthy source of carbohydrates for your body. So if you actually wanted a smoothie or a juice, you blend it yourself, you get some fruits and vegetables, throw it in a blender, and don't add anything else to it. And that should be sweet enough on its own that it'll satisfy your craving for something sugary. Vitamins or organic substances required in small amounts. Humans need 13 vitamins to survive. Functions are basically they help chemical reactions take place. They provide no energy to the body directly, but they do help unleash energy stored in carbohydrates, fats, or proteins. So you need to eat these in conjunction with carbohydrates, fats, and proteins in order for the body to fully utilize the energy stored in those other sources of food. Other vitamins are critical in the production of red blood cells and maintenance of nervous, skeletal, and immune systems. The sources of vitamins come completely from what we eat. Human body doesn't manufacture vitamins, so they all have to come from outside sources. The best source is fruits, veggies, and grains. Vitamin D is a rare exception. This is actually created in a chemical reaction when the skin is exposed to sunlight. And again, wearing sunscreen isn't going to prevent the creation of vitamin D in your body. It won't prevent the reaction from taking place. So load up on sunscreen. I will talk very briefly about supplements. Specifically, they're actually not that great for you. A lot of people will eat vitamin supplements every day. It's about half of Americans will take some sort of supplement, a dietary supplement, and research has shown, fairly conclusive research has shown, that it doesn't actually add any benefit to your health. Eating a multivitamin every morning isn't going to enhance your health in any way. It's not a substitute for eating proper foods. You're supposed to get those vitamins from what you eat. So instead of taking a multivitamin, you're supposed to eat an apple. There's a few exceptions to that. Usually menopausal women or people who have calcium deficiencies, doctors will prescribe calcium pills for you, then that's okay to take those calcium supplements. People who are anemic, low in iron, they'll be prescribed iron supplements, and then that's okay to take supplements. Usually it's only when a doctor prescribes them because your body isn't functioning normally, but those are in very rare circumstances. And for the most part, no one needs any supplement in order to be healthy, in order to have a full healthy diet. Vitamin deficiencies occur if your body lacks certain vitamins, then you can develop certain symptoms. So for example, if you lack vitamin C, you can develop scurvy. And this was a random fact. This was a very big problem on transatlantic shipping, or people working on those ships in the 17th and 18th centuries, because no one really realized, oh, maybe I should eat some vitamin C, so they'd constantly get scurvy. Children who do not have enough vitamin D develop rickets. Vitamin A deficiency may develop blindness. So interestingly, vitamin D may decrease heart disease. There's not it's not conclusive that it will, but there is a fair number of evidence. There's a fair amount of evidence that suggests that an adequate amount of vitamin D can help prevent heart disease. So again, lay out in the sun for 15 minutes a day, and you should be doing okay. Well, we talked about all these sources of vitamins and minerals. Let's take a quick 5-minute break, and then when we come back, we're going to talk about various other sources of nutrition. I'll talk a little bit more about supplements, and then we'll talk about the differences between organic food, inorganic food, and the various advertising techniques that companies are going to try to get you to eat their products or try to get you to think that their products are actually healthy. So everyone get up, get some water, take a nice little stretch, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi. I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. To want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back. So let's quickly finish up the types of nutrients that you can get in your food. The next one that we're going to briefly talk about are minerals. Minerals are inorganic elements that your body needs in small amounts to help regulate body function. Generally, you're going to get in a deficiency of minerals, you'll get anemia, osteoporosis. There's 17 essential minerals, for example, calcium, iron, potassium, and magnesium. You get them through the foods you eat. It's not going to be a very large part of your diet, but it is still an important part of your diet. Next thing that we're going to talk about is water, and water is very important. It's used all throughout the body, helps with digestion, absorption of foods, is the medium for which most chemical reactions in the body takes place. It's used also as a lubricant in the body. Water is in all foods, but in particular, they're in fruits, vegetables. You lose a lot of water each day by sweating, evaporating from lungs and urination. So you're supposed to drink about 3 to 4 liters of water a day, which is about 1 gallon, more or less. So just think about like a gallon of milk. That's how much water you should be drinking a day. Most people don't drink enough water a day because they don't either think that they're exercising enough for it, but that's just for baseline, what you're supposed to do, exercising or not. The more you exercise, the more you sweat, the hotter it is, the more water that you should drink. So if you exercise vigorously, live in a hot place, drink more water. One interesting topic on water that I wanted to briefly mention is that bottled water, while promoted as a better option than tap water, may not necessarily be any better for you than tap water. In fact, there's more government regulation on the municipal water supply, so on your tap water, than there is on bottled water. And more or less, they're gonna all come from the same source. So for example, if you live in Southern California, a lot of our water comes from Northern California or the Sierra Nevadas. That's where a lot of water bottle companies actually get their water, in underground aquifers and in springs that the city will actually pump their water from. So generally, it's not going to be any better for you if you're trying to, you know, save some money, pinch some pennies, and going out buying some bottles of water isn't going to be the best option for you. It's not going to hurt you, but generally tap water is going to be just fine. And then the last substance in food that we are going to talk about is antioxidants. You probably are going to hear a lot about antioxidants on television, on various nutrition shows, and how, oh, they're so important, they're the new superfood. Anyone who uses the term superfood, you should probably just ignore because there's no such thing as a superfood. Antioxidants generally occur when the body breaks down fats, proteins, and use oxygen. It produces what's called a free radical. I won't get into the chemistry of this. It involves electron donors way beyond the scope of this course. But basically, a free radical is a chemically unstable molecule that can damage cell membranes and mutate DNA. And when I say mutate DNA, that's not something It's not like in X-Men or a comic book where you suddenly get superpowers. Generally, what that does is it changes the molecule that attaches to the other molecule on the opposite strand, so that when proteins are produced, they're going to be produced incorrectly or non-functionally. So the coding for the protein will be incorrect, and your body won't be able to produce the protein, or your cell, excuse me, won't be able to produce the protein appropriately, and it won't function appropriately. So that's generally what a mutation is. So free radicals can cause this. Antioxidants can protect the body from free radicals. Basically, this works in a variety of ways, which have to do with electron donors, except chemistry, electron donors, electronic generators. It's a whole host of things that I recommend taking a chemistry class to find out. But needless to say, it works. Basically, they repair damage, prevent formation, and remove the free radicals. Foods high in antioxidants would be like the picture behind me. Blackberries, walnuts, strawberries, even red wine. And we like to say a moderate amount of alcohol intake would maybe be half a glass to a glass of red wine a night, and that would be very good for you, very healthy for you. We have a couple of questions coming in. So Breck asks a question. I find sodas addictive, and I have tried to limit myself from them, but I can't. Do you have any advice? This is actually very, very common. People will start eating a food or engaging in a behavior, and before they know it, they're actually addicted to that behavior or to that substance, whether it's drugs or foods or exercise or what have you, and they don't know how to stop or they can't stop. Some people recommend stopping cold turkey, so you just go throw out all the soda in your house and you just stop buying soda and drinking soda. That works for some, it doesn't work for others. Sometimes you need to wean yourself off of a substance, so if you're drinking sodas too much, if you drink a soda a day, set reasonable, achievable goals for yourself over the long term to wean yourself off. So you say, okay, this week I'm gonna drink 4 sodas. And then in a month later, you say, okay, I can do that. Now I'll drink 3 sodas a week. And then a month later, you say, okay, now it's only going to be 2 sodas a week. And you schedule it out, you write it down, you keep track of things. And the longer you do these tasks, the more likely you are to continue using these tasks. Another example, another thing you could try, this is some of the research that I engage in, are memory associations or unconscious associations that have formed in your memory that can actually influence behavior. These occur far more often than people like to think, and there's these unconscious impulses that will not force us, but nudge us to engage in a behavior that we normally wouldn't want to engage in. So if you're drinking a lot of soda, you're supposed to look around at your situations. What are you doing every time you drink soda? Is it every time you're at school at lunch you drink soda? Is it every time you go home after school you drink soda? Like, what's going on that causes you to drink the soda? And then once you consciously know what it is, you can substitute the behavior. So if it's you're coming home every day you drink a soda, you come home every day and you drink some water. Or you come home every day and you do an alternative behavior. And over time, that should change things. That should make things a little bit easier for you to do. It just depends on you. You can always engage social support from your friends or parents to help you, so people can remind you and say, I thought you weren't drinking sodas, give me that soda. It's going to be hard. Most things are, especially if you can't stop it on your own. But generally, with enough help and enough positive outlook, you should be able to change your behavior. Another quick thing, I see we have a call, so we'll go to the call. Let me answer this, and then we'll go to the call. You can start slowly substituting things for your soda. So if you really like soda and you hate water, switch over to diet soda. It's a little better for you than regular soda. It's still bad for you, a little better. And then you do that for a few months, and then you switch to iced tea. And then from iced tea, you switch to diet iced tea. And then you switch to unsweetened iced tea. And then you switch to water. And this will take years, but eventually you'll be able to stop drinking soda completely. All right, so that was a great question. I'm glad you asked it, because that kind of touches some of my research. So I see we have a call coming in. So let's go to Caitlin calling from Santa Clarita. Hi, Caitlin.
Hi. You mentioned how high fats can raise cholesterol. Well, I've known a few people who have done the Atkins diet, and their cholesterol actually lowered even though they consumed a lot of fats. Can you explain why this happened?
Sure. So it depends on it depends on the type of fats that they're eating. So unsaturated fats, so if they're eating a lot of unsaturated fats, they would have actually lowered their bad cholesterol and raised their good cholesterol. If they're eating a lot of trans fats, so if they're just going to In-N-Out every night or if they're just going to McDonald's every night and eating a burger, that would actually raise their bad fats. So more likely, they were actually eating unsaturated fats, which would have lowered their bad cholesterol and raised their good cholesterol.
Okay.
Cool.
Thank you. That makes sense. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for the call.
Yeah.
All right. So Jordan writes in a question. I was wondering if the way certain foods are prepared has an effect on their nutritional value, and how do you know the healthiest way to eat something? That's a really great question. I believe there is a fad diet that you're not supposed to cook anything that you eat because that unlocks the enzymes or the nutrients or something silly like that. Generally, there's no wrong way to eat something healthy. So if you like steaming vegetables, then steam those vegetables and eat them, and that's not going to damage the vegetable in any way. If you like roasting corn on a barbecue, roast up that corn and eat it, and that's perfectly fine. You know, go easy on the butter. Don't use any butter, of course, but the way you prepare a meal should be okay. The only exception to that rule is if you're frying food or you're cooking food in oils, you should be using canola oil or olive oil to cook, not vegetable oil or some other high fat oil. You shouldn't fry foods because that has a lot of trans fats in it. But generally, cooking food is perfectly fine. I believe there is even one diet that says you're not supposed to cook meat, which is absolutely ridiculous. Humans have had fire technology for about 300,000 years now, so we've always been cooking our food. And we've evolved cooking food, so we actually should be cooking food and we should be doing okay eating cooked food. Just, you know, go easy on the added extra stuff. So if you're eating strawberries, don't pour a lot of sugar on them. If you're eating other fruits, don't load up on sweet salt stuff or spicy flavorings that you put on there. That's probably not going to be the best option for you. Just plain fruits, vegetables are fine. If you like cooking fruits and vegetables, that's fine too. Frying stuff up is not going to be a healthiest option. So we talked about antioxidants, and I want to quickly move into how we need to make informed choices about food. Generally, if you have any concerns or if you're not sure what you can eat, you can always consult with a physician or with a nutritionist to determine the appropriate healthy foods that you should be eating. Generally, anything you could possibly need to survive will come from your diet. So be very wary of supplements. They're going to advertise supplements to you in a way that suggests that they're necessary or that they're going to promote health. But there is mounting evidence that they don't, at best, they will do nothing. And at worst, they can actually cause problems later down the line with your body constantly filtering out these vitamins and minerals that you're constantly ingesting. One other thing I wanna mention as we move on to other aspects of health is that when you go to the store and you see things that say, oh, it's all natural, or oh, it's vitamin water, it's good for your health, there are substantial limits and regulations on how food companies can advertise or promote things at you. So it can't, you, for example, pharmaceutical companies can't claim that their drug can cure cancer when it's not. That's illegal. But in certain instances, it's okay for food companies to slightly suggest that certain things are healthier than they really are. So for example, you could buy some white bread, and as we talked about, white bread is nothing but sugar. But you could buy a loaf of white bread that will say 100% all natural white bread. Now that invokes concepts of, oh, it's healthy for us, oh, it's natural, of course I want to eat it, because how is natural not good for you? Natural isn't a regulated term. Organic is a regulated term, and something that's organic actually means something, but something that's all natural doesn't mean anything. Now, I could say the tie I'm wearing is 100% natural, and that would be completely correct usage of the term. The white bread, of course, it's 100% natural. They used products that were growing on this planet in order to produce that white bread. Doesn't mean that it's good for you. One key point also is a lot of supplement drinks are going to be advertised as healthy for you. One of the big ones was vitamin water, which is produced by Coca-Cola. They said that they said in a lot of advertisements and a lot of brochures and signage that it's healthy for you. It helps reduce long-term disease, things of that nature, but it's essentially just colored sugar water. It has absolutely no nutritional value to it at all. There's a huge Supreme Court case about it recently, and I believe that it's still working its way through the courts, but that it was generally that's going to be a false advertisement. It's going to be a false claim of what it really does. So you have to be very careful about what things actually say versus what they do. So a good thing to do is get used to looking at the back of the labels on each food product. So you go down and you see, oh, how much sugar is actually in it, how many fruits and vegetables are actually in it, what's the vitamin composition of it. A lot of people think, oh, you know, Naked juice, that's very healthy, or Odwalla juice, that's very healthy, but there's a lot of extra sugars in it that your body doesn't need. They want you to drink it, they want you to think it's tasty, so they're gonna add a lot of simple sugars, which remember, simple sugars don't have any nutritional content to them, to make it sweeter. Your brain, you drink it, your brain thinks, oh, this is great, this is so sweet, this is so good for me. You're drinking it, so you're consciously thinking, oh, I'm drinking fruit juice, so of course it's good for me, how could this be bad for me? And you just end up loading up on empty calories, which eventually gets turned into fat, and you gain weight. So it's very important to be very mindful of what you eat and what you're putting into your body, and be careful of deceptive advertising claims. Remember, I talked about those memory associations earlier with weaning yourself off soda. If you really consciously look at advertisements, and I'll point out Coca-Cola specifically because I got reminded of it by the soda, you'll see a lot of their commercials will invoke feelings of happiness, friendship, and camaraderie. So in a lot of their advertisements, there's going to be a group of friends, they're drinking sodas, they're having a really great time, things are going really well for them. And over time, the more and more you see that, the more and more you're exposed to it, the more you're going to have this association with Coca-Cola and friendship and feeling good and having a good time. And you'll drink it, and the more you drink it, the more these associations will form or be strengthened, and then you'll find yourself that you can't stop drinking it, and you don't know why. So generally, you want to balance your calories when you're eating a healthy diet. Don't eat more calories than you burn through daily activities. Many Americans are overweight because they eat high-calorie foods without having a proper amount of physical activity. So generally, you want to have about 20 minutes of physical activity a day. Not heavy physical activity, but you know, you want to get up, walk around, maybe get your heart beating a little bit, and that should be good enough. The USDA, or excuse me, the U.S. government suggests or advises people to have adults to have around a 2,000 calorie per day diet. But that's going to be very dependent on your activity level. So if you're an athlete, you're going to need a much higher calorie intake. If you're a farmer and you're constantly working all day, you're going to need a far higher calorie intake than if you worked in an office or you just sat in class all day. You're not going to need as many calories. You need to adjust so you feel healthy and you have enough energy, but you can kind of measure how much you expend every day and how much you take in to find the right balance. If you take in too many calories, you'll gain weight. If you take in too few calories, you'll lose weight. If you maintain, you've taken the same amount of calories as you burn, you'll maintain your weight. You want to reduce salt intake to less than 2,300 milligrams a day. You want to reduce salt intake to under 2,300 milligrams a day. If you're over 51, if you're African American, or if you have any chronic conditions, that needs to go down even further to about 1,500 milligrams a day. One of the most incredible things whenever I've done a health intervention in the past, we always say, okay, so everyone, you know, write down what your foods you eat, and then let's look at how much salt there is. And people don't realize how much salt is actually added to food, either by themselves or by the company that processes the food. People add salt because it tastes good. It helps preserve the food, so any frozen food you eat is going to be loaded up with salt. Any McDonald's meal, any In-N-Out meal is going to be loaded with sodium, to the point where just one meal will exceed your recommended daily intake of salt. Now, your kidneys are actually very good, and they can filter out salt fairly easily. It's no problem. But if you eat too much salt over a very long period of time, your kidneys will be working overtime every day to filter out all that salt, and eventually you'll get kidney failure. This won't happen right away. This will happen, you know, in your later years. So remember, it's important to lay the foundation now for a very healthy future. And generally, what you want to limit saturated fats and trans fats. reduce calories from added sugars, so from sodas, limit refined grains, so no white bread and only whole wheat. So what you want to increase, fruits and vegetables, whole grains, low-fat milk, fat-free milk, eat a variety of proteins, fish, poultry, eggs. If you don't like fish, poultry, or eggs, feel free to eat beans, and limit your red meat. I want to briefly discuss USDA My Plate, because that's the new food pyramid. Instead of a pyramid, it's the shape of a plate. Specifically, they say that half of everything you eat, and this is my plate behind me, half of everything you eat every day should be fruits and vegetables. So that's a good rule of thumb to how what you should be putting in your mouth. Half of everything you eat should be fruits and vegetables. About a quarter of what you eat should be grains. Another quarter should be a source of protein, whether it's from meats or beans or some other non-meat source. You can actually go, I'm going to give a little advertisement to the USDA, United States Department of Agriculture. You can go to choosemyplate.gov and they'll actually give you a personalized meal plan based on your age, sex, weight, height, and level of physical activity. It's actually a great tool for people who are trying to live a healthier lifestyle. Maybe people don't know where to go at first. Things seem a little overwhelming, and that's very understandable, especially if you haven't been eating healthy up to this point. It's very difficult to just jump straight into it, so you can ease your way into it. You can ask for help. So choosemyplate.gov, it's going to be a great resource for people to go to. So generally, I see a couple questions coming up, and I didn't read them just for the sake of time, asking how many grams of proteins or should we be eating, how many cups of fruit should we be eating a day. Generally, you want 6 ounces of whole grains a day. So that would be the equivalent, an ounce is the equivalent of one slice of bread. So you'd essentially have one slice of bread a day, a small muffin, a cup of cereal, or a tortilla. Those would be 1 ounce, and you need 6 of those a day. You want 2.5 cups of veggies a day, 2 cups of fruit a day. You want slightly more veggies than fruits because fruits have a little bit more sugar in them and you want to cut that down just a little bit. 3 cups of dairy daily, 5.5 ounces of protein. So 1 ounce would be a quarter cup of dried beans, 1 ounce would be 1 egg, 1 ounce would be a tablespoon of peanut butter, 1/2 ounce of seeds and nuts. And then you want, about 6 teaspoons of oils a day. And that's really easy to measure. You just get a teaspoon and pour the oil into it. No sugars except what you get from fruits and vegetables. Every once in a while you can have a candy bar, once every 2 or 3 weeks. Every once in a while you can have a soda, maybe once every 2 or 3 weeks. But it's very important to, if you're eating a lot of those foods, to kind of stop or transition into not eating those foods. So if you drink a soda every day, you can switch to every other day, and then maybe every third day. And then eventually, over time, you'll just stop drinking completely. If you eat a lot of candy bars or a lot of processed foods high in sugar, you can transition slowly to more fruits and vegetables. You find a fruit that you like, and it's very important to find an alternative behavior that you like doing. So if you really like Snickers bars and you eat a Snickers bar every day, but you want to stop, maybe every Friday you eat an apple instead. And then eventually it's every Monday and Friday you eat an apple. And then every Monday, Tuesday, Friday you eat an apple. Until every day instead of that Snicker bar, you transition to apple or banana or mango or whatever fruit that you like eating. And then I'll finish up. We only have a minute left, but I'll finish up on organic foods. A lot of push has been placed on organic foods lately. They're not necessarily any healthier than non-organic foods. It's just that they will be grown without using pesticides. So if you are concerned about pesticides in your food, which is a fair concern, then you may want to switch to organic. Organic is going to be a little more expensive, so if it's going to break the bank or you're not going to be able to afford it, then don't worry about it and just make sure you get your adequate fruits and vegetables every day. All right, so we covered a lot today. If you have any questions, my email is in the syllabus, and I will see everyone next week.